Watching this movie reminded me that I have to see more Hammer movies. I love the look and feel of these Hammer movies, where the cinematography and set design emphasizes the colors and gothic feel. The Spanish setting of this movie also helps give it a unique, sunny look that isn't common in a lot of gothic horror movies. The werewolf origin story in this movie is pretty dark and heavy stuff, given that he is a product of rape and the mistreatment of the lower class. The great for its time werewolf makeup doesn't even appear until the last 10 minutes of the movie, but it doesn't really matter, as the first 80 minutes of the film make a compelling study of class and gender equality issues, nature versus nurture and sexual oppression, with a splash of comedy here and there, that I really don't mind the wait. At a glance, Christine should be nothing more than a fun movie about a killer car, but the two great minds of Stephen King and John Carpenter make it that fun movie and more. Both the soundtrack and the score are fantastic, with the former incorporating a number of clever song choices that Christine uses to communicate, and the latter being chilling, minimalistic, and dark nighttime driving music. This movie is filled with your typical high school stereotypes, such as Arnie the dork, Lay the hot smart girl, and the long-haired, knife-wielding bullies, but it never takes itself too seriously and acknowledges these tropes in a tongue-in-cheek way.
Look, you wanted me in college courses? I'm there. You wanted me in the chess club instead of in the band? Okay, I'm there too.
One highlight of the movie is the physical and behavioral transformation of the nerdy Arnie, played wonderfully by Keith Gordon, as he begins to work on repairing Christine. The other highlight is Christine herself, and all the personality that is put into this car using only old songs and great special effects. The majority of this movie isn't really a horror movie, but rather a comedy drama about a guy who tries to rehabilitate his addicted best friend by handcuffing him to a cabin in the woods in which he was squatting. Throughout the film, they discover a bunch of clues, messages, video clips, and audio recordings that suggest that some omnipotent presence is watching over them. These characters are very well written, and their chemistry together really sells their relationship and makes us care once all the creepy shit going on in the background begins to threaten their lives. While resolution doesn't really deliver too many scares, the concept of being watched and recorded is rather creepy. I also love the meta aspect at the end of the film, and how we don't really get a resolution in this movie, but rather in its companion piece by the same directors, The Endless.
Fuck! Holy shit! Holy shit!
What? What's happening?
There's somebody outside.
Do they have my stuff?
No, it's some girl. She looks crazy or sick or some shit.
Oh, God.
You're not scared?
Oh, man, she's probably from the New Agey mental health house up the street. They wander out all the time.
Oh. Making another Tetsuo movie is a very big risk, because there is no way that you're going to be able to live up to the iconic original movie. Body Hammer does not quite live up to the original, which remains one of the most unique, strange, and creative movies I've ever seen, but it takes some of the themes from the original and gives them a sort of remix while adding in the themes of family values and childhood trauma, creating one of the best, stylistic, and over-the-top Japanese splatter films I've ever seen. Body Hammer is more of a traditional movie than its experimental predecessor in that it has a straightforward narrative about a man taking revenge for the death of his son. Like the Iron Man, Body Hammer is a fun, action-packed, and stylish splatter film with a great score that also has more going on beneath the surface and a memorable ending. If I have one complaint about the movie, it would be that it does drag a bit in the middle, as it is rather repetitive and probably would have benefited from being around the same length as the Iron Man. Another sequel that just nearly lives up to the original, Hellbound does a lot of things right, and one thing wrong. One thing that does right is bringing back the characters of Christy, Julia, and Frank, while also introducing us to new characters and playing with our expectations about what their arcs are going to be. What I really love about this movie, though, is the trip into the Cenobites' world and the creation of one of the most grotesque and creative Cenobites in the franchise. One thing they did wrong was go into the Orton of Pinhead and the other Cenobites. I have some mixed feelings about this decision, because the fact that the Cenobites were once human and were turned into sadomasochistic monsters is rather disturbing, but the way in which this is used to defeat them is a bit anticlimactic, and whenever you try to explain a horror icon, it ruins the mystery around them that made them so compelling in the first place. There is a lot of debate in the horror community as to what is the first slasher movie, and A Bay of Blood from 1971 is often suggested. I personally think that while being highly influential to the genre, to the point of having its kills stolen by the Friday the 13th franchise, it doesn't really qualify as a slasher because it doesn't have one crazy person doing the killings. But man, does it come close. What with the Bayside setting, the sex-crazed teenage slaughter fodder, and the killer POV cam. The second half of A Bay of Blood reveals that there are actually multiple parties killing each other in an attempt to own the property around the bay, with the most likable characters being the weird ophthalmologist and his crazy wife.
Oh! The least you could do is to answer when I call.
Stop shouting, you disturbing little Ferdinand.
While the plot is convoluted and complicated with many changing alliances and flashbacks throughout, it isn't impossible to follow, and it's really fun to see all these unlikable characters kill each other off, complete with a huge fuck you ending. Hagazussa, I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing that right, is not for everyone. This is the type of slow-paced, experimental art film that you really have to let yourself get hypnotized by to get the intended effect. The difference between a movie like this and my least favorite movie on the list, Sombra, is that not only can I see what is going on in Hagazussa, but the visuals are beautiful, and even when not much is happening, I can appreciate the movie as a piece of moving gothic visual art. While I watched the film in a sort of trance, especially during the later half of the movie, when the protagonist actually takes magic mushrooms, I was still able to comprehend what was going on in the movie. The plot of this movie is actually rather dark and depressing, and while I didn't really have an emotional response to what was happening while watching the movie, it really got under my skin afterwards and stuck with me. This mini-series created by Mike Flanagan is a bit like when, as a kid, your mom would hide your medicine in some sort of sweet treat, in that it's a family drama dealing with heavy themes like grief, the repression of childhood trauma, addiction, and suicide, and all that other stuff that's good for you, disguised as that new scary Netflix ghost show. Ooh. The ability for the horror genre to tackle very real themes through the use of both real and symbolic ghosts, ghouls, zombies, and vampires, and put very ordinary characters into extraordinary conditions, is something that continues to attract me to the genre, and all of the following entries in this list do this in some way. With 10 hours to work with, there is a lot of time to flesh out these often likable but very flawed and relatable characters, and all of the actors do a great job, with maybe the exception of some of the child actors who were likely hired more because they were cute and not for their acting ability. The show is also pretty frightening at times without relying on cheap, meaningless jump scares that serve no purpose other than to startle the audience, rather choosing to employ background ghosts that you don't always notice, but when you do, oh god, oh fuck, fuck you! The last bit of this review is going to spoil the ending, so if you don't want any spoilers, skip to the next part of the video in 3, 2, 1. I have mixed feelings about the ending of the show, which kind of feels like it suggests that killing yourself or dying in a haunted house is not such a bad thing. To clarify, I'm going to cheat and use an additional sentence here. I don't think they intended this rating of the series. I think that the Dudleys were just making the best of a bad situation, and the father only killed himself so that his children could be freed from the Red Room and live a full life. But the very warm, melodramatic, and rather cheesy feeling of the ending made Hill House seem like a pretty good place to haunt as long as you can put up with Poppy's shit. George A. Romero has said that Martin was the favorite of all his films, and while I don't entirely agree with him, I could see why. Shot during the summer of 1976 with a budget of $100,000, Martin is a very haunting film about a young, sexually repressed, and possibly mentally handicapped man who may or may not be a vampire. The ambiguity of whether he is a vampire or just a dude who drinks blood, and his relationship with woman, really makes this movie compelling even when it is slow, and the raw cinematography and moody score enhances the overall feel of the film. There aren't many kills in this movie, but the kills that are present are very effective and suspenseful, especially the sequence in which Martin's would-be victim turned out to be having an affair, throwing a wrench into Martin's schemes. In addition to the movie's central theme about folklore being an exorcism of our own evil, I also found the movie interesting in how it deals with the theme of hereditary mental illness, as one wonders if the reason why Martin might think he's a vampire is simply because he is told he's a vampire all his life by his family. Hey, it's me editing here. I just wanted to clarify my last statement because it doesn't really make sense. I think the movie is toying with the ideas of nature versus nurture, the passing down of tradition, and becoming what you are expected to become. Mental illness doesn't really have anything to do with these themes by themselves. For example, if my dad was a farmer, I might grow up thinking that I have to be a farmer because I am a farmer's son, even though that's not necessarily true. Similarly, if Martin is human, the reason why he might think he is a vampire could be because he is expected to be one, because he is told that he is one, and that vampirism runs in the family. I know this review is now a 10-sentence review, but I think it needed to be said as it really wasn't clear what I meant and I didn't want people to think that I didn't understand what mental illness was. Moving on. Nosferatu.
Nosferatu. I am your cousin. I am your cousin, Martin.
You see, it isn't magic. Even I know that.
In 1968, Romero created the modern zombie and made them scary. But 11 years later, with Dawn of the Dead, he made the zombie a rather pathetic and farcical creature, going as far as having them actually get pied in the face. In both movies, however, it is clear that the real enemy has always been ourselves. The satire and social commentary throughout the movie is sharp and wide in scope, covering subjects such as the media, urban housing, racism, rednecks, and of course, consumerism. While the zombies standing in for the ultimate consumer is quite obvious, the protagonists are also hypnotized, as Francine puts it, by living in the mall. And the reason why things go wrong at the end is because it gets trashed and they start shooting at living people.
It's ours. We took it. It's ours.
Even though none of them were truly happy living there. All of the four main characters are really fun and interesting, except for maybe Francine, who I would have liked to see fleshed out a bit more, but that's my only complaint for this fun action-adventure zombie flick that has both a lot of guts and a lot of heart.
What do you think, bag it or try for it?
You game?
I need lighter fluid.
You got it.
Jesus Christ. They're maniacs.
All of the good things I said about The Haunting of Hill House, I could basically say about Lake Mungo, as they are both very cathartic stories about coming to terms with the loss of a loved one, with a bunch of creepy background ghosts that send chills down your spine. I've seen people complain that Lake Mungo is a bit of a one-trick pony because all of the scares are the same formula of zoom in on figure in the background of a hazy photo or video, but the repetition honestly doesn't bother me too much in the context of it being a fake documentary. As a fake documentary or mockumentary, the movie comes across as so incredibly real that I had to constantly remind myself that I wasn't watching actual real people. The acting in this movie is superb and comes across as so naturalistic and awkward, just like a real documentary. While the movie can be scary at points, the fact that the figure that keeps on appearing is the ghost of a loved one communicating from across the grave, and the facts are uncovered about her final days, makes this movie more tragic than scary, and I finished it feeling glad that these fake people, and myself, were able to get some closure.
You scared of dying?
Yeah, of course I'm scared of dying. Isn't everyone scared of dying?
Candyman.
It was kind of bittersweet to watch, as I think I've now watched the introduction movie to every major horror icon.
Man.
Is full of social commentary that touches on issues such as gentrification, urban housing, racism, and class, all while exploring the cultural importance of urban legends and folklore. The main character of Helen, a graduate student who is studying the myth of the
Candyman,
a hook-handed man who kills those who say his name in the mirror 5 times, is a rather interesting and complex character. Unafraid of the urban housing building that she approaches as an outsider, but rather concerned for its residents' safety and weary about coming off as exploitative. Of course,
Candyman
himself complicates matters as he beckons Helen to be his victim.
Be my victim. Be my victim.
But has rather special and unsettling plans for her that aren't as simple as simply killing her. There's a lot more I could say about this movie, but I'm just going to list off a bunch of things I loved about this movie. The fantastic and haunting Philip Glass score, Tony Todd and his echoing voice, Virginia Madsen as Helen, the fact that they used real fucking bees during that one scene, its subtle and complex exploration of its themes, the actual horror elements like the kills, though they are pretty sparse, and of course, that fucking ending. Holy shit.
Candyman. She turned out the lights. What he saw turned his hair white from shock.
The Wailing is the type of movie that almost requires a rewatch to be fully appreciated, as there is a lot to take in on your first watch, and a lot of interesting details you might miss. The Wailing is not an easy movie to understand, especially since a lot of it is left ambiguous and can be interpreted in many ways, and a lot of the clues to what might be happening can only be deciphered if you are familiar with Korean shamanism, so it's best to just not worry about figuring it out on your first watch. In The Wailing, the forces of good and evil go head to head, getting a simple but flawed police officer who just wants to do his job and protect his daughter caught in the crossfire. The Wailing is often said to be about the incomprehensibility of evil, but to me it's also about the incomprehensibility of good, as it asks us whether the notions of judgment and justice are truly virtuous. Philosophizing and theorizing aside, The Wailing really is a fantastic, sometimes funny, but mostly unsettling, horror movie experience that I can't recommend enough, and the only thing separating it from the next movie on the list is its rather generic score.
겁나 무섭지라.
I watched The Witch for the first time a couple of years ago and I liked it well enough, but I have since seen this movie being circle jerk in various film communities on the web, and with Robert Eggers' new movie The Lighthouse coming out, I decided to give it a rewatch. The Witch, I am so sorry that I ever doubted your greatness and gave you an 8 out of 10 on my first watch. I love this movie, because like Blake Mungo, like The Haunting of Hill House, like Hereditary, even though it is a horror movie, you don't watch The Witch for the horror, you watch it for the family drama. Despite its 1630s New England setting, the family in The Witch is not too different from our own families, and every character, from the father who tries to keep them together, the grieving mother who is quick to anger, Caleb the eldest son who wants to please his father and prove his worth as a man, and of course Thomason, the eldest daughter who takes on all the responsibility and receives all the blame, who just wants to be loved. I'm only scratching the surface here, and a lot of this has been said before, but it needs to be said that between the beautiful cinematography, the wonderful score that is used at just the right moments, the slow-ish build-up and atmosphere, the fantastic acting, the well-written characters, and the witchcraft itself, this movie is fucking brilliant, and I am even more excited for The Lighthouse, which is supposedly even better.
Hey, it's me here editing this video. I saw The Lighthouse and I just wanted to say that as a horror movie, The Witch is better than The Lighthouse. I would classify The Lighthouse as an absurdist comedy first, and a psychological thriller second. It never really becomes a horror movie, though it is unsettling, especially near the end. And I do think it is a better movie than The Witch, but The Witch is a better horror movie.
Get back! You should stop that!
This was a very challenging video to make, trying to put everything into 5 sentences, and I even cheated. None of these sentences are really grammatically correct. There are lots of run-on sentences with semicolons and lots of commas keeping them together. It was a very interesting challenge for me, and I really enjoyed making this video, and I hope you enjoyed watching it. You can probably tell that I'm without script right now since I am rambling. But anyways, if you enjoyed watching this video, please consider subscribing to my channel. I talk about a lot of weird movies on this channel. So if you enjoy that, or if you just want to see more from me, please consider subscribing and giving this video a like if you liked it. I would really appreciate that. So long, and stay weird, folks. Goodbye.